여러분들은 안녕하십니까? Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for coming. And most of you must have read the title of today's talk. And that is Plastic Surgery for Your Face. And this is not a commercial. Most of you who go to Korean movies, before the feature starts, you can see many advertisements. There are many people who would want to redo your face. Do you want to redo your face? If yes, do you want to use surgical methods for that? To start with, let's go back a couple of hundred years. What kind of ideas we had long time ago in China about our face? We have a wonderful teacher, a great master called the sixth patriarch in Korean, Henung Sunim or Yukcho Desa. And he got transmission secretly from the fifth patriarch, and he fled because they started to pursue him in an attempt to take away the relics that have been transmitted from the Buddha's time, the robe and the bowl, which signified true and correct transmission at a material level. So as he was fleeing, he got caught up by a very, very good pursuer who used to be a military man before becoming a monk. And his name was Haemyeong. So Haemyeong Sunim, after a day of chase, caught up with Henung Sunim, and Henung Sunim saw that in an open combat, he stands no chance. So what can he possibly do? He put the relics onto a rock, open field, and then he hid himself behind another big rock. When Haemyeong Sunim reached it, he sees the spot, he sees the relics, and he starts to reach for them and in an attempt to pick them up. But he couldn't move it. He couldn't move either the bowl or the robe. And he got really frightened. So he says, younger brother, please come out. I mean no harm. Huineng, as we know him, he comes out and Haemyeong Sunim was very, very surprised. Henung Sunim says, when you don't think of good and bad, what is your original face? Haemyeong Sunim heard that and got enlightenment. There are other aspects to the story, but they're not relevant at this point. What we should know that after 17 years, the sixth patriarch became actually publicly and officially patriarch. And before that, he just minded his original face. In fact, when we talk about Hua Du Son or Kan Hua Son, when we use this question, what is this? This sentence refers to this original face, this sentence by the sixth patriarch. Yeah, we can also ask, what am I? But when we ask, what is this, that refers back to this story long time ago in Tang Nara, in Tang Dynasty, China. So it seems that even without surgical methods at hand or movie commercials, we were interested in some original face that we may have, which is not this one. Everybody looks at the family album sometimes, right? You see yourself when you were a toddler. Newborn babies, they have very distorted faces, of course, necessarily, because after childbirth, it's a big trauma for them, for all of us, to be born. Sometimes lighter, sometimes stronger, but we all have these contorted faces after the first couple of days. And then our faces just got a little bit more straightened out. Then as you turn 3 or 4 years old, some kind of individuality, some kind of shine in your eyes begin to convey some message. And then as we grow, our face changes. Changes by the year, changes by our eras, how we cover different periods of time in our lives. And by the time we get old and wrinkled and prepared to die, then our faces are very different from child time or even middle age time. So what is it that changes us besides impermanence? Besides just getting older and older and older? What is it that changes your face? And if you practice, you can discover that. You can even discover that during a good holiday, when you truly have some rest, your face becomes a little bit smoother. Your forehead is more even. You don't reflect so much stress into the environment. And then your face reflects your mind. But when you practice, that also changes your face. And only you know the difference. If you ever tried consistent meditation, probably that's better than plastic surgery. Definitely less expensive. But we don't do that for the makeup. Changing your face by meditation is not really a primary objective. The primary objective is really to wake up and save all beings from suffering, first and foremost from the suffering that we would inflict upon them. So you don't have to go up to other people and say, "Excuse me, can I have your suffering? I have a very good garbage bag for that." That's not the point. The point is, save the world from the suffering that you would inflict upon that world, upon all people. And if we can do just that, we are fine. But most people are not satisfied with what they see in the mirror. And it's okay to have some makeup from time to time, ladies, because that goes with life as we live it. But for some people, it's really not enough. And I'm not talking about those patients who are recovering from some serious car accident or some very bad spill on somebody's face who do need plastic surgery to reintegrate into society. I mean that kind of surgery when it's not enough. It's already good what you could see, but it's just not enough. And this not enough mind goes again to the surgeon, and 6 months later again, and again, and again. Even pop stars are like that. Some of them. Not all of them. Some of them. So the question is, can you really hide your true face? Can you really hide the mind behind plastic surgery? Or a makeup? Or some kind of clever way to masquerade yourself. Because if you don't like the face, you put on a mask. There are also many masks in history that we try to use to disguise ourselves or pretend a different identity from what we are. So this constant urge for plastic surgery is an urge to change your identity. And we are immediately in the ballpark of our meditation practice, because on our path, you are supposed to truly attain our true nature, our true face, what we truly are. And this is primarily important. There's no way you can hide your karma with a few clever cuts and other masterful moves in the plastic surgeon's office or operating theater. So what do we really want? That will come out on your face. Even if your palm changes because there is some surgical procedure, the lines reproduce themselves. So you can change the physical layout of your face, but the expression that comes from that will be the same. It will not change. When does it truly and fundamentally change? It does change when your heart does. So if you don't like what you see in the mirror, then of course, you should, if you're a man, you should shave, or if you're a woman, do some nice makeup job. But if you fundamentally don't like what you see, then maybe you should look deeper than the physical aspect. Deeper, because there is something which determines not just the face that you got this lifetime or the face that you display and represent moment to moment, but also the body that you got, also the life that you live. And because of that, go to the central element, to the central agent which determines what kind of face you got this morning or this lifetime, and that's your heart, that's your mind. So, how do you get a plastic surgery for your mind? Can you do that? It doesn't have any tissues. It doesn't have anything you can operate on. But there is something which will be also the subject of next week's talk. Your clear mirror. Your clear mirror consciousness that can naturally sort out things that you don't want anymore, you don't need anymore, you can safely discard. And then things that you can build in to your way, you can build into your life. Some wisdom, some compassion, some things that you actually don't discard because you want to use them later. Huang Po, the great Chinese master, said, just take out the garbage from your mind. Then everything is clear. It says unnecessary things or litter or burden. It's all synonymous with that. So that's your karma. So whatever karma you have is reflected on your face, but first it's in your mind. So catch it before it manifests. And that's why practicing is so important. That's why practicing somehow mentally rejuvenates you. It doesn't give you longer years. I don't mean that. Sometimes practitioners die even sooner than normal people because they use themselves up. But what kind of face do they have when they die? Does it reflect the harmony and accomplishment and contentment with life? Or does it reflect something missing, something hard, something left in torso, unfinished, or distorted? So when we get old, everything that we have done in our lives are reflected on our face. So why not start today? Why not start looking at your true face today? And then you can truly go on the path when you don't need any scalpel from clever surgeons. Because no matter how much you want to change your face physically, you cannot change it mentally then. But if you reverse that and you change the way you speak, feel, think, and act, then these changes are reflected on your face. And for that, I think everyone has a chance. You don't need expensive procedures for that. Okay? So I think this is plenty for introduction. And if you have any questions concerning meditation, then feel free to ask.
Is there anything spiritually immoral about getting plastic surgery for your face just for cosmetic reasons?
No, there is nothing immoral, but it cannot do more than what it seems to do. So if you're beautiful anyway, then plastic surgery will not make it better or worse. You
are talking about internal beauty.
Of course.
Yes.
By the way, Zen is not really about moral judgment. In fact, this path is so non-judgmental, but extremely consequential. So cause and effect are very clear, and we have a very kind of explicit and clear sense of moral wisdom, but we don't cast the dice. We don't prejudge for people what's right or wrong.
If someone is getting plastic surgery to feel better about themselves, but it's not a path of effective practice to really know themselves, right? So what I'm trying to ask is, if they get plastic surgery, but they haven't dealt with that inner sense of self that's actually troubling them, does the plastic surgery create any kind of a negative karma, or do you think it makes it harder for them
to obtain?
No,
I don't think it's negative karma. But what you can expect, that after a few months or years, when the emotional or mental problems recreate themselves, then the person may want another plastic surgery. And we could see examples of that. Poor Michael Jackson was like that. And he really wanted to look like Diana Ross, because she was his ideal from childhood. And that's why he started to look like that after several, if not dozens, of surgical sessions. It never made him happier. It just made him look different. So you be the judge. We always encourage people to see cause and effect and go deeper. Hence the challenging title, plastic surgery for your face. Because, again, what kind of Buddhist teaching can be about that? But the thing is, you have to go deeper than just the challenge. That's the point. And there's nothing wrong about it. But it remains on the surface. That's all it does. And people want to change themselves by changing the form. But if deep inside there is no meaningful change, then they just applied a form. In a way, cutting my hair, putting on monk's clothes almost 20 years ago, was like surgery, not plastic, but a surgical operation called chulga, leaving home. But if people in monk's robes really do not apply themselves in practice, and they do not follow the path earnestly, it just remains a form, a mask, or an altered face, an altered form. They're called rice bags in Korean Buddhism. Rice bags, yeah. Because they just store rice in their stomach for some time and that's it. Nothing else. More questions?
How do we change ourselves? Our inner selves?
Very good.
Ah, thank you.
Don't lose the mic, you may need it. So, how do we change ourselves? So you go into your kitchen and you don't like what you see. How do you change it?
You go shopping.
Immediately?
If you have
time. You go
time.
Into the kitchen and you see a bunch of dishes undone.
Ah.
Or some dirt on the floor. Or some leftover pizza on the counter. Or toast from breakfast and it's already evening. What do? Go shopping?
You clean the kitchen.
Great! So first, there's the shock of realization. You go into the kitchen. We call that, in Buddhism, stopping. You stop the mind. Because you don't go any further. You don't go watch television. You don't do your homework. You don't call your friend. You don't call your mom. You first stop and look. And that look is sometimes frightening because you see all those dishes that haven't been done. Everything on the floor, all the leftovers, everything. So that's when you first stop and look inside. In every Buddhist tradition, whether it's Theravada or Mahayana, you have these two concepts, stopping and looking. I'm not going to go into languages and cultures at this point. It's not necessary. But you should know that the basic technique is that you don't just go on your usual path in life. You stop and you look inside and you ask, what is this? In a kitchen, it's very simple. It's a bunch of dishes to be done. But deep inside your mind, it's not so clear.
Right.
Because your thoughts and your emotions are all mixed up. Your past, your present, and future, they seem to overlap. You and your relationships are at best interdependent, sometimes seriously, absolutely convoluted. What can you possibly do? You stop and you look and you see things for what they are. And as strange as it may sound, most of the time, we don't do that. We want to get what we want. We want to attain our goals. We want to live up to our ideals. In other words, we are chasing illusions most of the time. We call that ignorance. And out of that ignorance comes anger when we don't get it or we get something that we don't want. Or desire, when we actually get what we want and we need more.
Right.
All right? So the big turnaround happened not just to the Buddhas and patriarchs, but it can happen to all of us because we all have the potential to attain awakening. We call that Buddha nature. It's a very generous term because in a formal way or in a conceptual way, it doesn't exist. You can't just quantify it like a lid. You can't say it's made of glass. You can't point at it inside or outside. If you say it exists, it's a mistake. If you say it doesn't exist, then who is listening, who is talking? That's equally wrong to say that it doesn't exist. So that's why we say don't know. That's why we say a mind which does not use concepts for its operation. Okay? A mind which is beyond thinking. So you can use it in many, many ways, especially when people need positive terms for encouragement. Then we say Buddha nature, enlightenment nature, original face, whatever, substance. You can even demonstrate that, because when you hear the sound, there is no thinking. At that moment, you return to your true face or true nature, and right after that, you can re-engage in your karma. But before the hit and after the hit, it's not the same, because you heard something. You perceived at least a little bit something. So with our practice, half an hour can make a difference. But even 30 years may not be enough. So when you stop and look, you recognize your own homework inside, just like you recognize things to do in your kitchen. It's simple. It's way more simple than in the sutras. The sutras, don't forget, they are the result of somebody's practice. In fact, a group of very highly attained practitioners. It's not just the Buddha, but his students, the dramatis personae, sometimes Subhuti, sometimes Mahamoggallana, sometimes Ananda, sometimes others who ask the questions, and therefore the teaching develops. And sometimes it's total outsiders, sometimes it's laymen. But what's amazing about this, that the true nature of the teaching comes out. And it turns out, throughout the 84,000 volumes, that there is something we can call the potential for enlightenment in each and every one of us. So if you stop and look inside, you can do your homework. Inside homework. If we don't do the homework, that's also okay. You just trample along, you just go, 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 carrying your burden, that's all right. But dying with that burden and being reborn with that burden is something for you to decide. Do you want to die with the mind you have today? Or you would like to maybe improve yourself a little bit? Take out the garbage, do the dishes, clean out the pizza slices, things like that in the kitchen, and maybe a little quality change within yourself. Because if you extend generously your lifespan to not just one incarnation, but a few hundred before and maybe a few hundred later, then carrying this burden for lifetimes is really not a good option. And you are the owner. You are in charge. Some time ago, no matter how many minutes, months, years, or lifetimes ago, you put something into your mind and identify with it, and that's what you call self. How long do you want to carry that? How long do you want to believe in that? How long do you want to see your face like that? That is the question. And when you make a decision, then you can really stop and look inside. And just to use another metaphor than kitchen, trains in the old days, they were different from today. So if you go to Seol-yeog or Yongsan-yeog, you can see the Mugunghwa. That's the old style. Even Semaul-ho is very modern. 30 years ago, there was no Semaul-ho, only 20 years ago. KTX, count 10 years back, there's only plans, okay? So in the old days, you can see that the engine and the cars are separate. Mugunghwa has a strong diesel engine, old style. So they went to a garage and they stored the engines there. In KTX, it's different. Semaul-ho also different. And when the engines came out of the garage, there was a turntable. In some old railway stations, you can still see them. In Europe, definitely. So the engine stopped. And the turntable turned. And then, when the necessary railway got connected to to the turntable, then the engine started to go. It was very efficient. It didn't have to go out of the railway station, then through many forks and switches come to the necessary railway. So if you see what I mean, your mind can do exactly the same. We are running like KTX, so we have no options because we see only what we want. So we run at 300 kilometers per hour. And if somebody wants to stop you, you get angry. But when your own frustration stops you, when your own failures stops you, when your own crises stop you, then there's no one to blame. So then you stop and stop and slower and slower and slower, and then you ultimately come to a halt. That's when you get this moment. And this moment is this historic old turntable, when your engine finally has a choice. You have no action, so you have an option. So you can turn your direction in life anywhere. And when you feel that you are connected to your true target, to your true railway, then you start again and then all the cars follow. I hope this metaphor makes sense. Because the other extreme is also true. Some people love to be on the turntable, not going anywhere. Only options, no actions. That's also a mistake. You can see option man and action man, ladies included in this case. Okay? So too many options, no action. Attachment to action, no option. So what is it that gives you choice? Only your own mind space and clarity can give you choice. And for that, you have to stop and look. And maybe ask yourself, what am I doing? Where am I going? Is this the life I want to live? Is this the person I want to be? Is this the action I want to do, the speech I want to speak, feelings I want to feel? Is this how I want my face to look? These are the questions that don't depend on religion, but our own environment, Buddhism, can offer very good ways of practicing. More questions? Everybody is too happy. That's the problem. If you really had a problem, you would have all your hands up in the air. You think the Buddha did your job 2,500 years ago? You think the sixth patriarch did something for you maybe 1,300 years ago? It's all true, they did their job, but they didn't do your job. If you look inside, your reason for being born is there. Deal with it.
If you're on the turntable looking at your options, and you, how do you know which action to choose?
Okay.
How do you know what your job is?
Okay. Let's get back to the metaphor. You have the metallic ends of the turntable and the various railways that can be connected. Where there's a spark, you have connection. And I'm saying this because most of the time people want to know. But how can you know with 5% of your consciousness, which is our conscious thinking, what the 95 wants? And most of the time, even if you practice hard, you don't have an insight deep enough that you would say, I now completely know and understand something. Because our concepts are so limited. It's like trying to fish out the sea with a fishing net. You can't fish out the sea. Maybe you can catch some fish. If you're lucky. These days, there's not much left in the seas. But you definitely cannot fish out the sea. This is like trying to attain the complete universe with conceptual thinking. You can't. But you can become one with it. So if you choose the right way, you can go beyond conceptual thinking and become one with the universe. Attain the substance of it, and like a little drop of water returning to the ocean, you become one, and you become the ocean. So with the turntable, if we get back to the previous metaphor, there's a spark, there is a zzz, there is something which you feel deep inside resonating with you. And if you're honest with yourself, then that direction is correct. Well, many times we are not exactly honest with ourselves because we know what we want. We have second thoughts. We have reservations. We have a lot of things in our backyard. But remember, this is a turntable that can appear anytime, any place. You just have to stop and look at your options and cease your actions. That's why in the old days they said mu wi or wu wei in Chinese. That means not moving. They were not really just about physical non-movement. That non-movement actually not moving mind. A mind which is not engaged in dualistic thinking, feelings, actions, and speech. And when you really stop and not do anything, then your options, your choices, your direction can appear. And then you again, based on your previous experience, hard way of getting to know yourself, where you have BS'd yourself, that means that's where you were not honest. That's where you were not sincere. That's where your karma covered your true self. That's where your blind spot in the mirror appeared. Once you have corrected that, then you are wiser, better, more compassionate, and then you choose your direction with that kind of experience in your mind. But then another karma is exposed, another kind of crisis appears, and then you stop again and you have the turntable effect. Then you choose maybe the same direction with more wisdom or a different direction. But once you have a little smell of freedom, a sense of liberation, you will not choose any worse options than that. So in another way, with another engine, with another railway, but somehow the same direction is sensible. Same kind of direction, although the methods can change, the exterior can change. These metaphors actually serve as a cognitive, you know, groundwork, but it also serves to take away a few ideas. One idea is perfection. That one day, I'll be just perfect. Well, not in this body. Never expect that to happen. You may be sufficiently awakened. This is wonderful. You may be feeling very good about yourself. You may be but to line yourself as I am perfect, that's actually the biggest blemish you can ever make. Same way with any other spiritual positive qualities. Why? Because the I cannot get it. If you have I, then all these very wonderful ideals and spiritual qualities, they never apply. They never do. That's why Lin Chi Zen Master, in the old days, he said, even uttering the word enlightenment is like pouring a bucket of shit all over your head. And he wasn't overstating. You know, people were pretty much obsessed with these things anytime that they set about practicing hard. And in Tang Dynasty, China, there was like 360 golden years before the Song, when there was relative peace and prosperity, and most of the rulers, they were Buddhists. In fact, it went so well that the last Tang Dynasty emperor closed down hundreds, if not thousands, of monasteries and sent home about 600,000 Sunims, forcibly disrobing them because society was turning too peaceful and transcendental. And for a worldly power like an emperor, it was not motivating enough. There was not enough suffering, there was not enough crisis, there was nothing to manage. And then the ruling class is not so important, plays a secondary role. And the self-importance of politicians and power holders is something that cannot be overstated because it's always there. So if you don't have enough suffering, you make some. And that's what happened. And for that, what you have to do is take away the transcendental dimension of a certain society. And then suffering necessarily appears. And this is from someone who grew up in a socialist and post-socialist society. Things were not bad in the 80s, the last decade of socialism in Hungary, but the transcendental dimension was severely diminished and repressed. And the Catholics used to have a saying during the 40 years of socialism, a pruned tree will bring fresh green leaves. They were right. They were right. The Yi dynasty in Korea, it was 500 years. Still, the values of the Shilla, they prevail today. So never mind the last 20, 30 years of political establishment in Asia or Korea. Transcendental values, which people hold dearly to their hearts, they can prevail. But they can be helped or hindered by a certain administration. That's when direction comes out. That's when your real and true will, your direction can come out. And something goes against that. Then what kind of person are you? So in the face of a crisis, all your qualities come out. And then stopping and looking is not a bad option. Then you can use the crisis to make good decisions. If you go back to certain critical era in your life, you can see that certain decisions as consequences are still with you. You go shopping, and next week you go shopping again, and every week you can change your stock in the kitchen. But you can't change your life every week. So certain decisions that you made when you were 16 or 18, they are still with you today as a consequence. Okay? So be mindful of those decisions. It's not just about family and job and money and power. It's about your mind. So what kind of mental burden or mental option did you take upon yourself when you made certain decisions? Did you decide to become vengeful or desirous or greedy or ambitious or etc., etc., etc.? Did you make that decision? Did you allow your mind to become that? Because that's reflected on your face very clearly. More questions? Any kind?
How do we know which decisions are good ones and which decisions are bad ones? And what do we learn from them, and how do we move forward to correct?
There are several ways. One is your intuition. In fact, your deep intuition is not just your gut feeling. It's a lot more than that. Your intuition works flawlessly, moment to moment. Why can't we use it? Because our thoughts and our emotions, our attachments, our ideas, they all cover it up. So we mistake our true self with some illusory identity we call ego. And because of that, our intuition doesn't have the full signal. Sometimes we just see the noise. We don't see the signal. So at the intuitive level, the moment you face that situation, that kind of decision, intrinsically, implicitly, you already feel it. Everyone does. Except we can't access that most of the time. It's filtered. It's covered. That's why practice has meaning, function, and a purpose to clear away that dust, to clear away that noise. And if we cannot do that right away, then cause and effect teaches us if our own direct perception cannot. And that's what this life is about. That's what this illusory linear time, which we have to take seriously, and the three dimensions of space, and all the cause and effect relationships, and everything is about that. So if you truly attain the mind, which is beyond birth and death, you have the option to be born consciously or stay out. And if you're born, you're not born for yourself, for your own sake. You serve higher purposes than just yourself. So either you intuitively perceive it right at that moment, or you need a certain time frame to realize the consequences of your choices by cause and effect. But the best is make it clear sufficiently that right away you can become one with that option or situation. And then through the relationship you can see whether you want to do that, say that, or not. Cause and effect are infallible. Why? Because it's not a person. Cause and effect is not personal. If it was personal, somebody could hijack that, corrupt that, buy that, politicize that, elect that, depose that, impeach that. But fortunately, karma is not such quality. It works through our minds, but it's not personal. Cause and effect are therefore flawless. Does this make sense? So look and perceive clearly. And if not the moment itself, then linear time and cause and effect in time and space will teach you. And if you really listen to your heart, you can feel it. All right? Good. More questions?
What is the effective way to stop mind or clean the mind?
Can you stop the KTX?
No.
You are not the driver, so you cannot stop the KTX. You can only get off the KTX at a given spot. But with your mind, you are the driver. You have the controls. But most of the time, we are unaware of it because we can't even see the dashboard. So first of all, when you want to stop your mind, you first stop your body. That's why we say, not moving body, then not moving speech. Not moving speech means shut up. Very important. Don't pollute the world with your own speech and thinking. And then can come not moving mind. Now that's the trickiest part. Because if you want to grab it and hold it, it creates a duality like a policeman and a perpetrator or suspect. Now, if you want to have that duality in your mind, be my guest, but that's not our practice. So what we do is we redirect the energy back to its source, to the Tanjon, instead of fueling our thoughts. And when you redirect the energy, then soon your mind becomes clear like space, clear like a mirror, because your thoughts just have no fuel to run. In other words, you can't stop the KTX like that. And if you have the necessary controls, you can slow it down. But before you see the controls, how do you stop the train? You turn off the electricity. You disconnect from the power source. That's what we need to do in the first couple of months or even years of our practice. Just redirect the power where it came from, because you don't see how to control this complex machine which drives this body and produces your speech, produces your thoughts, produces your feelings. So at first, it's not a sophisticated thing. And practice most often is not pleasant at first. This is not a pleasure ride, but it's something deep and true. So because of that, we can practice. Because we rid ourselves of all these illusions that I will make myself happy. Well, congratulations. It's not going to work like that. So practice at first means perceive what your mind is doing. Take the energy down. Do not fuel your thoughts. Definitely don't check your mind. Don't want to grab your thinking. Don't make anything. No ideas. Definitely no policeman and suspect chase. That you want to stop your thoughts like that. No. And then when you have this kind of energy focused in your tanjon, then you may use some methods, either using a mantra or a question or perceiving the sounds. There are many others, but I teach these three because I've tried these three. And even then, your thoughts will produce some background noise. But that's no longer intentional. It will be tolerated because most of the energy doesn't go into that. And you're not chasing your own phenomena. You're not chasing your own illusions. So you stop and become one with this moment throughout the means of your practice. Either of the three. Perceiving the sounds is the lightest. In fact, sounds are just the instruments because you become one with the one who hears it or what hears it. Next is the Hua Du Son, or the great question. It's not a doubt, people. Doubt is when you have zero or one. Should I eat kimchi pizza or gorgonzola? That's a doubt, okay? But the great question has no doubt because there is no decision to make. So it's a question, and that question goes back to the source of the question. So what is this? That means, what is the source? The one who hears it and the one who asks it is the same. And the other is, when you really have a rough ride, then you turn on your yombul or mantra and you use that as an anchor point. In each of the three cases, you become one with this moment. And that moment, the experience of here and now, is your unmoving mind. It doesn't mean that your thoughts do not appear or disappear, or some emotions do not come and go. But the fact that you don't touch them, you don't attach to them, you don't identify with them, that means you essentially stopped. You stopped running. You stopped following. You stopped wanting. So some events can still be there. You have to be in a real deep samadhi so that nothing would appear. But becoming clear, becoming perfect, is different. Therefore, this half-open-eyed Tanjonho, Tantian breathing, and great question meditation, Huaduson, is different from Samme or Samadhi. It's different because Samadhi is this really nothing appears, nothing disappears, but there is no consciousness either. You have mind, things appear and disappear. No mind, nothing appears and nothing disappears. But then how do you attain? How do you get wisdom? How do you get compassion? So then you lose your instrument because you disassembled your train. You disassembled everything. Everything went back to its source. But then there is no progress, no vehicle, no mind, therefore no need for clarity. There's a total obliteration. That's very deep samadhi. People can come out of it, of course, but samadhi practice is something that is still done mostly in monasteries because it's very hard to match that with everyday life. You make one mistake, your mind catapults somewhere, and a truck hits you. You just relapsed back into your samadhi practice, and you and this moment became totally separate. So, very different. This moment, you can stop your mind, and look, and perceive, and also tolerate some of the noise, some of the coming and going in your mind space. That's good enough. Okay? You're welcome. More questions?
Right, so I was just thinking that if we are just a pond in the forest, the reason that we get attached is because it would be lonely to just be a pond.
Actually, we love those animals that come.
Yeah.
We want to give them water.
Right.
We love their looks and smell and skin and the way they communicate, and we enjoy them.
Yeah.
So sometimes, it's not even narcissistic, because sometimes you just really like your thoughts and your emotions and those of others coming in there. The problem is, when the animals not just drink, but they also take a swim. So they jump. Yeah. They jump right into the pond, and then all the mud comes up. And if you looked at Sir David Attenborough's magnificent documentaries, especially the Africa series, you can see that when they start to run out of water, then the animals actually fight. And there's only mud. There's no more water. And many of them die. So the same is true about your mind space. If your mind space gets cluttered up by thoughts and feelings, impulses, various forms of consciousness, then this clear water is lost. It can be all drunk up. It can be all muddy. It can all become hippopotamus, giraffe, lions, panthers, antelopes, zebras, water hogs, you name it. So how could we get this water to reappear? First of all, you have to wait for the rainy season. How does it rain in your mind? How do you get back the clear water in your mind? Well, get to the source of it. And for that, you really have to stop and not give any more water to your herd of wild animals, but actually stay still and wait for the drops to accumulate. And then, when we have a sufficient amount of water, then we can give some more to our favorite animals. Otherwise, they all die. And in Africa, in the sub-Saharan region, in the savanna, in the many, many millions of square kilometers, you can see these riverbeds that are dry 9 months of the year. And suddenly, boom, the rain appears. Everything comes to life. Everything is nourished by that water. And in 3 months, it's all over. It's all finished. So in our lives, how do we maintain that? How do we maintain the even flow of this water? How do we clean up the mind space sufficiently that our true self could function? Okay? That's what practice is about, and that's why I leave the questions open. It would be superfluous and not exactly truthful to talk about results here. Zen is a lot more about questions than answers. A good question is worth 10,000 sutras. So if you ask the right question, then it's like choosing the right direction at the turntable. Then your train can go and follow that light, follow that direction, follow that route. Then the answers will come. In fact, due to your ability to attain those answers, we don't give them for you. You should do it for yourself. Then they're all yours. If not, it's just some prepackaged Buddhist food which you may not even want to digest. It's not your own experience. More questions?
I have an ex-chief in my company, and he came back to his origin country. Now he resides there in foreign country, and I've got mail from him a few days ago.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes. He was very interested in Buddhism in Korea. So when he departed from Korea, I presented some materials and some books of your Venerable Chong An Sunim.
Mm-hmm.
And he wrote me, he continued reading your book, Sunim. And
is that really good for him?
Yeah.
Are you sure about that? Okay, let's see how he survives. Yeah. So, mm-hmm. Continue, please.
And he wrote me, he will continue to read and study Buddhism.
Mm-hmm.
But he told me, in foreign country, without any companion or friends,
yeah,
he go in the way to Buddhism. It's a very lonely path.
I know.
He told me. I don't know, but I feel some compassion to him. So he never asked for me something, but I want you, Sunim, that tell something to him to overcome any problem that he can encounter or meet in his past.
Okay, so my dear Carlos, if you're looking at this over YouTube, which I hope you do, let me reassure you, you're not alone. We are here, connected heart to heart, with all of your friends who are practicing. So if you practice, you're not alone. And by the way, you have a wonderful chance, since you're a very sociable person, to organize more of your friends into a small group and practice from time to time together. So if you like what you read, if you like what you see, you can get other people to know it, and naturally some good sangha can develop around you, even if it's just a few people. You know what is critical mass? Two, because it's more than one. So if there are two people, then you're no longer lonely. Three is better, actually, because there's not so much discussion. So it's wonderful that he continues, you know, to do something. And for some time, he may be solitary with his practice. But eventually, the nature of Dharma is that it spreads. People will be asking him questions, naturally, even without knowing that he's practicing. But since he's practicing, he cannot leave certain elements out. When he sees the benefits of meditation, he will naturally share that with others. So it's not about convincing people, let alone, heaven forbid, proselytizing. This is not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a natural conversation over a dinner table or over some lunch with somebody who has a serious problem or a question and you happen to have some angle at it. And then the person asks, how can you possibly know this? Well, maybe meditation helps. And that kind of approach is much better than hitting the gongs and the drums and, you know, spreading the good news. There is no good news. There's always a potential. But that's where it ends in terms of good news. Everything else is work, something we need to do. But once it's done, the quality difference is with you for lifetimes. Make no mistake, this is not some religion when people actually get invaded by others and you have to swallow the good news or you end up in a very bad place. Fortunately, I wouldn't be here. I would be in that very bad place, most likely. So, but the fact of the matter is, if he keeps his mind open and if he has some regular practice every day, sorry, not every day for public, but every day himself, and maybe opens it up like once a week for his friends, soon this lonely thing will finish. But if he doesn't practice, only reads, it's not going to help. The cookbook is not the food. Have you ever seen anybody eating the cookbook? That would be really stupid. But we eat the food based on what we cook, using or not using the cookbook. So like that, if he uses the reading, it's great, but he has to cook it. And then people can get a snack of it. Then naturally it happens. All right? Good. Any other good friends abroad or ex-chiefs? Or good. More questions?
I've been practicing here in Korea for a few months, alone mostly. And last week I went to Lotus Lantern to stay just one day. I talked to the Korean monk there with tea. I'm sorry. He suggested that maybe I look for a teacher. So now I'm looking. At the time I said, I don't know, only a woman teacher, this, that, you know. But then I thought, oh, I should. You know, he thinks so, maybe so. So I sent Lotus Lantern an email in English, but I have not heard from them. Maybe it's too complicated. I'm sorry, I can't speak Korean, so I'm learning. So now I'm just looking for someone. I don't know what that relationship would be like. You know, like a negotiation or something, or what the time, I don't know. So if you have a recommendation, that would be great. Thank you.
Well, if you want to negotiate with a teacher, then I think I'm at a loss. Okay. If you want to connect to a teacher, maybe I can help you. Okay. Negotiations can take place in two major areas. One is politics, the other is commerce. If you don't want political negotiations, which would bring you to diplomacy, or commercial negotiations, which is bargaining, then there can be a very lively dialogue or interaction between you and your teacher. So, the issue of getting a teacher. Now, in a non-executive mode, getting a teacher is actually not just your choice, it's the teacher's choice as well. There's a rule. A student can abandon the teacher can never abandon the student. I've seen it otherwise, and it was always terrible. So once a student is genuinely connected to a teacher, as long as that karma lasts, as long as that inyon has power, that relationship can be very beneficial, even if the teacher is sweating tears, even if the student feels sometimes terrible. That is all noise. It passes. But there's something very important through that bridge which goes through mind to mind, heart to heart. And if that connection is there, treasure it. Male teacher, female teacher, human teacher, animal teacher, doesn't matter. Worse than animal teacher also doesn't matter. But if the true heart-to-heart, mind-to-mind connection is there, then something can open up. That's the meaning of that relationship. Not the transmission of knowledge, you can read it in a book. Not the transmission of methods, you can learn it from anybody basically who's done 15, 20 years of meditation. It's not the true meaning of teacher-student relationship. One important aspect of it is that the student can wake up to the same level as the teacher just by being in the same time and space or having mind-to-mind connection to that teacher and intuitively following that. If you feel that this kind of connection is there in your life, it's a rare gift. You don't give up your spiritual autonomy just because you are connected to a teacher. So your free will doesn't bounce back to a robot pilot and you're happily cruising into nirvana. That's not it. True teacher lets you make mistakes, but also doesn't make you make mistakes. So this is a really important thing because when we're born, we are naturally connected to our parents. But very few parents can truly give us spiritual teaching or something beyond the horizon of worldly life. For that, we have to look elsewhere. Even the Buddha didn't find that within his own family. He had a royal, total, absolute, pure ancestry. Yet he had to leave home. His dad would have made him first a prince, and then a ruler, a great king, conqueror of many territories and nations. But when he realized that he would die pretty much in the same way, with the same mind as anyone else, he started to look for a teacher. And he found some, and then he started to practice on his own. More questions? Any kind? Last few. Yeah, it's okay to have multiple teachers at some point. But just like we don't have multiple parents, even if you have stepfather, stepmother, foster father, etc., you have one biological mother and one biological father. So just like that, you have to have a root teacher and a root tradition where you are rooted. And that kind of loyalty is your life insurance if something goes wrong. So people these days want a lot of teachers, a lot of teaching, so that they could get the best of it. So many options, many teachers, then lots of headache and big stomach problem. They can't digest it. So I have seen Dharma accidents in the West from very intelligent people. They were reading too much. They were mixing religions. They were mixing lineages. They were going to too many teachers because they always wanted to get better, 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 better on the outside. But it doesn't make them look inside. So first have your root teacher, your root tradition, and take a little beating. That means your teacher has to sometimes really admonish you and far from physically. First, your character has to change a little bit so that the job would start inside. Your teacher would actually point you to the right direction instead of you running around like a little dog looking for new food all the time. So once you have your root teacher and your loyalty to him or her and your root tradition, then having multiple teachers around is no problem. But in spirituality, there is no equality and there is no democracy. Very important. Our karma makes us all different. And the structure based on hierarchy is not democratic. But it works. And it works with wisdom and compassion built in. Why can it work? Because it has different purposes from everyday society. It's not about getting a job. It's not about getting some money. It's not about accomplishing something on the outside where you rightfully expect democratic systems, fair trade, fair share, fair trade, etc., etc. Many times your teacher puts you into an unfair situation. Was it fair when Bodhidharma had to build three huts and all the three of them got destroyed? Was it fair when Milarepa went up and fed himself 28 years on nettles? Was it fair when the Buddha practiced 6 years and he almost died? There's nothing good or pleasant or fair about it. But when you want results, you push yourself to the limits. And that's what your teacher helps you do. And it doesn't feel good. Sometimes it doesn't feel right. But you do it because you have faith. And you believe in that root teacher and root tradition. So multiple teachers are very much okay. But if you don't have a root teacher and a root tradition, you cannot get the job done because your options do not narrow down sufficiently. You're not put into a tight situation. Okay? So loyalty pays back. Loyalty, sometimes unquestioned loyalty, pays back. And then plurality is not a problem. Okay? Yeah, go ahead. If your thoughts and notions and emotions make you unhappy, how about changing them? That would possibly not make you unhappy. How can you accomplish that? First of all, let's get back to the very beginning for a moment. What does your happiness depend on? Does it depend only on you or maybe on other people as well? Answer me. Correct. If you said either one, I would have had to juxtapose the other. So it depends on you and your environment, yourself and your relationships at the same time. So can you just do this alone? No, you can't. Can you just depend on other for that? No, you can't. Great. So now how about sharing your thoughts and feelings with others? And if you get the reflection back, then there's a chance it will be happy. Because if you can make the other person happy, then that comes back to you. It's a positive feedback. And if you don't overburn it, it can last for a long time. There's nothing wrong with positive thinking, but immediately we turn them into desire. And then we overburn that. Even desire is not a problem, but we overburn it. And if that kind of burnt out feeling comes, then it started out as love, and then it ends up as depression and frustration. So, perceive cause and effect. Perceive relationship. And once you know that you just cannot make yourself happy on a long-term basis, it's a very selfish and solitary and ultimately unsuccessful direction, then you're happy through other people's happiness. And once you realize that, then you're on the right track. And since you have to do your part and the person has to do his or her part, it's not relationship dependence. That's also a psychological disorder when you're always dependent on somebody else's opinion. All right? And I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about true heart-to-heart interaction, connection. Such relationship where the reverbs of your thoughts and feelings and actions, they make each other happy. Try that. Works with, your boyfriend in one way, and in a very different way works with the community. You know, community energy and partnership energy or couples energy, different, necessarily different. But it works not just with one-on-one. It works in a shared and distributed and necessarily altered way in a group too. What is it that serves the group's purpose or good feeling? Koreans are extremely sensitive about group atmosphere. So if somebody comes into a room and immediately perceives what's going on there. So what kind of speech can I give? What kind of actions can I do? Dependent largely on the atmosphere, in Korean, 분위기. Okay? So if you don't have a good atmosphere, then your own 느낌, your own feeling, your own impression can also diminish. Okay? And what you bring in, that's your 기분. That's your own emotional stock that you bring in. Okay? So there are many concepts how to kind of groom this, how to make this happen. But for that, you have to have sufficient clarity and sufficient non-attachment so that you could perceive what's actually going on in one person or in a whole group's consciousness. I mean, if we just started to do that within a generation, we could clean up so much about our relationship karma. It would be awesome. But if you look at humanity, 7 billion people total, we repeat most of the disastrous patterns day after day, year after year, generation after generation, lifetime after lifetime. We end up in the same blind alleys of total and absolutely disastrous emotions, thoughts, speech, and actions just because we want happiness for ourselves. And it doesn't have to happen. You change your view, you change your concepts, then happiness also changes function. And if you put happiness into a larger context, like interaction, or group, or family, something greater than yourself, then the byproduct can be happiness. But if you directly want it for yourself, it will just evaporate. It will be so transient, so vulnerable, that you can never really get it. And if you get something, you can't keep it, because all of it was for yourself. It's very vulnerable. So once it's based on some relationship, once it's based on some group function, on some common direction, then it's solid, like the spokes of a wheel. Okay? Good. Last question. Om Mani Padme Hum. Same function, different words, different meaning. See, Mahabhanya Paramil is the beginning of the Heart Sutra. It means great transcendental wisdom. Mahabhanya Paramil. Mahaprajna Paramita. Okay? Great transcendental wisdom. Om Mani Padme Hum. Padme is lotus. Om is universe. So universal lotus, open up. This is Om Mani Padme Hum. But attaining the opening of the lotus, which is a symbolic way of saying attain enlightenment, or reciting great transcendental wisdom, ends you up in the same room. Whichever you like. Two trains, same terminus. Okay? Very good. This was very short. Time for one more. Personal financial debt. What do we teach about that? Well, that's when you need to negotiate. First of all, don't lose the mic. You will speak, guaranteed. So, are you in debt? Okay. Look at the source of that debt. First, you have to make sure it doesn't reproduce. So once you kind of cut the leaks, then you have contained it. Once you contained it, you have an owner of that debt. And you have certain parties or one party involved, if it's a bank or some private persons, etc., etc. And what is really important is to settle that debt, both financially and mentally. That would settle it. Because when you talk about personal financial debt, it's not enough to pay people. People should feel that they have been paid besides their bank account, so that they would have an enough mind about it. That is, they were paid this much, and that is enough. Usually a contract settles it. So if it's contracted, it's okay. But if it's not contracted, then sometimes people expect some interests or something more, as like connecting the material and the mental together. And people are extremely good at connecting these two, and most of the time it's totally irrelevant. You cannot become somebody's friend because you have to pay them. It's not like that. But in many parts of the world, they would oblige you for a lot of things because you are in debt towards them, and not just financially. All right? So make sure it's paid, materially and mentally, and the good news is there's no other karma involved. It can go without a trace once it's paid, or if it's a big financial institution and you can't keep up with the mortgage, then you have to declare personal bankruptcy because certain states allow that, but not in Russia. So don't do that in places where they can really hurt you for not paying. That's my point, all right? So that debt can be forgiven or settled. Because if somebody says, okay, I consider myself being paid, never mind the money. Mentally, I consider myself being paid. It's all set. I even sign it if you like. So, and then it's a mental settlement. So the material and mental usually go together. They depend on one another. And you should see that each area is taken care of. All right? Nothing special, nothing else. And make sure it doesn't happen again because it's not a pleasant state. Wonderful. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think we have seen some aspects of our faces, whether it's physical or mental. Also, we have seen how much indebted we can be to our teachers, our tradition, or sometimes even to each other. So I hope that one day we can convene again together and share the Dharma again, even if it's tomorrow or next week or the months and years after that. In that way, we can bring about very, very positive changes in our minds and lives, attain the great way, and save all beings from suffering. Thank you for your attention.